It's time for sports.
Good morning and welcome back to another edition of LTCC Sports. I'm Dan Androlamo here with Natalie Gomez, and we have a big day of sports ahead, so let's get right to the action. We have the NHL playoffs to start off. What a series between the New York Islanders and Washington Capitals, going all the way to Game 7. Let's get into the action. Game 7, Islanders and Capitals gearing up to stay alive in the Stanley Cup playoffs. Islanders are trying to make it to the second round for the first time in 21 years. In the first, Joel Ward receives the pass, and he'll get two quick shots off of Yaroslav Halak, but neither see the back of the net. Then it's Mike Green hovering around the point, and he'll rip a shot, blocked again by Halak, who is not ready to go home yet. To the second period we go. Ovechkin is going to fire a pass across ice to an open Peter LeBlanc for the blast, and it's Ward who cleans up the trash at the front of the net to put the Caps up 1-0. Ovi is loving it. Now to the third period. The Islanders on the attack, trying to tie. It's going to be Franz Nielsen with the goal through the five hole of Braden Holtby. Probably should have been stopped, but the Islanders will take it. Game tied at 1, 7 minutes to go in the third. Evgeny Kuznetsov takes the puck through the middle, puts the team on his back for the goal. Caps take a 2-1 lead. Look at him celebrate. Gotta love the intensity. And the Capitals defense with one more chance. The Islanders trying to make it through, but shut down by Holtby, and the Capitals will hold on for the 2-1 victory. Ovechkin with a ceremonial handshake, and he's got to be excited to go the next round.
Most notable during the 80s when the Islanders were a dynasty winning 19 consecutive playoff series and four straight Stanley Cups, the fans have witnessed greats of the game skate on the Nassau ice, including Mike Bossy and Clark Gillis, as well as a legendary coach behind the bench in Al Arbor. Though the Isles have been a bad team for a long time, this team in particular gave the fans something to be excited for in the last season of the Coliseum. At one point, they were the most dominant team in the league early in the season, but ended up having to back into the playoffs. Still, those three playoff games in the Nassau brought a lot of passion and energy from the fans. And even though a first-round exit may be disappointing considering where they were early in the year, the Islanders can move on to Brooklyn with some hope as we say goodbye to the hockey at the Coliseum.
The New York Rangers and Washington Capitals matchup should be a good one. According to NHL.com, this will be the fifth time these two teams will have faced each other in the playoffs since 2009. Both teams have won two series each, with the Rangers taking the last two wins in 2013 and 2012. If history is any indication for this series, the fans will be treated well. Three out of the four previous series between the teams have gone seven games.
Coming up after the break, we have a feature story from our very own Josh Kaling on the FDR High School women's softball team. Stay tuned.
Motivation, a force or influence that causes someone to do something. Last year in Hyde Park, New York, a group of 13 girls on the Franklin D. Roosevelt softball team had one goal in mind going into the playoffs, to win the Section 9 Class AA championship as the one seed.
I think our girls got in our own heads, whereas everybody started to try to be the star rather than focusing in on our team goal. A lot of the girls wanted to be the one to get. Our field, which we did very well, but at the same time, when the other team's hitting and you're not, they're putting runs on the board and we're not. We didn't make any plays happen. We barely put the ball in play. Good teams like that are gonna put the ball in play, are not gonna back down. And that game, I feel like we just kind of handed to them.
The Presidents ended their season losing 5-0 to the fifth seed Warwick in the semifinals.
I think we came
came out really flat in the first like couple innings, and we didn't hit at all. And I think everyone had really high expectations of us, so it was kind of disappointing to be at home, especially, and to lose in the first round, being seeded first.
This year, the Presidents look to use the past as motivation as they start this upcoming season.
One goal, and that goal is to get better as an individual and as a team.
This year's team is led by senior captain Allison Pritchard. She's one of the star pitchers on the team, as well as one of the big bats in this year's lineup. Why motivation? A new season means new goals.
I know it's going to kill you guys if you guys don't show up to play against the beast. You guys have to bring your game every single time because the teams that you don't think that are out to get you are out to get you. Yes, some teams are weaker, but then there's other teams that are just as strong, if not stronger, as they were last year.
With the combination of power pitching, solid hitting, and stellar defense, the team aims to dominate the regular season to gear up for the state tournament. By the time the season ends, the team looks to slide their way home to win a state sectional championship.
After a 3-1-2-3, I'm here!
We seem to be experiencing some technical difficulties, so we apologize. See what had Clippers fans feeling like another early playoff exit was just around the corner, coming up after the break.
Welcome back to LTCC Sports. Let's head to the game, to game five of the first round of the NBA playoffs, where the six-seeded San Antonio Spurs look to upset the number 3-seed Los Angeles Clippers. Let's get to the action. Game five, and Blake Griffin is ready from the jump, finishing off a monster slam in the transition. Chris Paul showing why he is one of the best defenders in the league and running the fast break, throwing the lob to DeAndre Jordan for the slam. And Bomber is loving it. The Spurs aren't done yet. Ginobili with the three, bang. Look at Timmy run the floor to get behind the defense for the easy 2 points. To the fourth quarter we go. Hey, look at the hesitation by Paul to blow by Green for 2 points. Spurs down by two. Parker gets in the lane, dumps it down to Duncan for the lay, cripples to the lay. Clippers come back, and Blake decides to get it in on the action, throwing the lob to Jordan to cut down the lead to two. Griffin at the line, three, and pulls a DeAndre Jordan, breaking both. But the Clippers aren't giving up, fighting for the loose ball. Paul kicks it out to Crawford for the three. No good. Down by one, Griffin gets the ball in the lane, floats one at the rim. Jordan with the basket, interference. Green hits. Harden from the Houston Rockets. I mean, the 6'5 shooting guard has led the Houston Rockets to advance to the second round in the NBA playoffs. In his last five games, against the Dallas Mavericks, he's averaged 28 points. He shot 47% from the field goal, 39% from three-point field goal, 97% from the free throw line. He grabs 4 rebounds a game, dishes out 8 assists a game, and 2 steals a game. I mean, the 225-man can do it all, and his stats speak for themselves. He's been playing his best basketball all season long, and it's great to see he can perform the same way with much pressure on him now that him and his team are in the NBA playoffs. The best thing about all is that he has the best beard in the league. I mean, he has a serious beard and serious game, and there's not much better than that. I just love watching him play because he's such a smooth lefty shooter, and he's just so fun to watch. He doesn't force anything. He lets a game come to him, and he's just no matter what.
So, good stud for me. I'm going out to Golden State with Steph Curry.
Right.
I mean, has there ever been a player that America has fallen in love with more than Curry? It's amazing. You never hear a bad thing about this guy. He put up MVP numbers in the regular season, averaging 23 points and 7 assists. And something about when the lights come on, when the moment is the biggest, Curry plays his best. He did it at Davidson, and now we're seeing it in the NBA. In the sweep, though, of the Pelicans, here's his point totals for each game. 34, 22, 40, and 39, and those were all Golden State wins. Especially in Game 3, when Curry engineered a 20-point fourth-quarter comeback, including a ridiculous late three-pointer over Anthony Davis to send the game to overtime. There was even a picture online, I don't know if you saw it, with his eyes were closed when he was shooting. I mean, this guy is a magician on the court, and he does whatever he wants with the ball, and there's no surprise why many NBA experts predict him to be the MVP. But, you know, you have your highs and you have your lows. Yeah. I know we were talking about duds.
And not depend just on Duncan, Ginobili, and Parker for all the game. He just needs to, I just want him to play like he can score 13 points every game. And actually, if the Spurs beat Clippers tonight, they will face the Houston Rockets in the second round. So I'll definitely be watching that series because it's my stud against my dud. And they'll definitely be playing against one another, so that'll be a good matchup.
So my duds, in wrap-up, mine's Tony Parker. I know he's hurt. He's not 100%. He's got injuries to the quad, ankle, and calves. But besides that game four when he broke out for 18, really hasn't had a lot going for him the whole series. So Tony Parker and Kawhi Leonard both need to step up for the Spurs in order to become back-to-back NBA champions. Now that the first round is coming to a close, let's take a look at some of the more surprising first-round matchups that are still going on. The Atlanta Hawks and Brooklyn Nets series has really stood out because the Hawks were one of the best teams during the regular season, going 60-22, which was the best record in the East. But now they are struggling to put away a Brooklyn Nets team that limped its way into the playoffs with a record of 38-44, good enough to get them the eighth seed. The series has been closer than expected at 3-2 in favor of the Hawks, but the series will head back to Brooklyn for a crucial Game 6. The Hawks rallied back after dropping two straight games with a horrendous offensive performance in Game 3 to win Game 5. The Hawks are not going to want to head back to Atlanta for a Game 7, so Brooklyn will try to continue its spectacular play and ride the wave of star big man Brook Lopez, who is averaging 21 points, 11 rebounds, and 2 blocks per game this series. Will the Hawks become just the fifth one seed to fall to an 8 seed, or will Brooklyn find its place in history? Game 6 will be Friday at 7 p.m. Eastern Time. Let's see if Brooklyn can stay alive and not the series at 3 apiece and try to take out the number one seeded Hawks.
Another surprising matchup in the first round of the NBA and the Larry Sanders fiasco. But now with the series tied 3-2, the Bucks are led by the team first-year head coach Jason Kidd, who hasn't missed the playoffs since the 1996-97 season. Whether it be as the player of a coach, clearly he is doing something right, leading this underdog Buck team to a Game 6 against the battle-tested Bulls. Another surprise in the series is the terrific play from the Bulls' backcourt of Jimmy Butler and Derrick Rose. Jimmy Butler is averaging 26 points and 6 rebounds per game. And Derrick Rose finally healthy in the postseason. All right.
When we come back, I'm going to take an in-depth look at one of the most unique program opportunities at Marist College, the Marist College Center for Sports Communication and ESPN The Classroom.
The Marist College Center for Sports Communication is a program at Marist that employs Marist students as interns. Along with hosting guest speakers and summits, the Center for Sports Communication produces a show for both radio and television called The Classroom.
So The Classroom is a partnership between the ESPN affiliate of the Hudson Valley, Fox 1220, 95.7, 94.1, ESPN Radio, and the Marist College Center for Sports Communication. And through that partnership, we produce a weekly two-hour radio program that takes a smart look at big sports topics. So we don't do scores and highlights and things like that, but we take a look, as they say, outside the line.
Well, the ESPN Classroom show that we have is it's a unique situation, with, like Dr. Schroeder touched upon in his interview. Students get real-life experience, and we get to work with real-life equipment that hopefully we'll be working with when we graduate. I'm in charge of running the audio board for the classroom, so during our show, during the two-hour show, I have all the sounds up for what we need. And when I get my signal, usually I know when it's coming, but either Jeff Brawl or Strother will signal to me, and I'll play my sound, play that need. I connect to the FoxNet radio to make sure that we're on ESPN and that we're streaming. And then after it, we are a partner with American Education TV.
Is one of the things that happens. One of my situations as well is that it's good to have an internship going in your senior year, but I don't have the time to go into New York City like most students do. So it gives me the opportunity to still work in my field and still have the convenience of it being on campus.
So this week's episode was really interesting. I like that one of the stories was baseball related because I'm a big baseball fan. So we talked about the lack of African Americans playing in youth and professional baseball. And, you know, it makes me think back to, you know, I'm a Mets fan, 1986 Mets, that some of their most predominant players were, you know, Darryl Strawberry, Doc Gooden, and, you know, those were all African-American players. And now, as Dr. Schroeder pointed out on the show, it's kind of hard to think of African-American players in baseball. You really have to think hard to pick them out because it's mostly Cuban, Dominican, or Hispanic.
The classroom remains a great and unique opportunity for all Marist students interested in pursuing a job in the sports world. I'm Ben Hayes, reporting for LTCC Sports. Back to you guys.
Coming up after the break, our very own Mike Collins will be with 2014 first-team All-MAC midfielder Drew Nesmith talking about the upcoming MAC playoffs.
Thanks, Dan. I'm here with senior midfielder and good friend Drew Nesmith. Drew, how's it going?
Good. Doing good.
So, you know, you got the MAC semifinals tonight. That's a big game. How's the team feeling about that?
Oh, they're feeling great. You know, there's just honestly a feeling in the air that we're going to take it all this year, and we're really excited.
Yeah, you know, you guys went 6-0, wrapped up that number one seed, which led to the tournament being here at Tenney Stadium. And you guys have only lost one game at home this year. Would you say you guys like to play at home more than on the road?
Definitely. We definitely like to play at home more than on the road. You know, the road, you got to get through the bus ride. You have to stay in a hotel. You eat different food. You don't know when your next meal is going to come, especially with our coaching staff sometimes. So definitely better to play at home.
Yeah, no, and I've heard the smell on those bus rides are brutal. But, you know.
Get those conference wins, which we're always looking for. So I think just having that motivation, knowing that if we got the number one seed, it would be at home, it really motivated our guys.
Yeah, that's wonderful. So you're one of five players on the team with 100 points, and that's a really fine accomplishment for a Division I athlete. And can you just walk me through some of the personal steps that you take to score, you know, 50 goals, have 50 assists, that type of thing?
Yeah, I mean, honestly, it starts in the fall. Our coaching staff, our offensive coach especially, Coach Gongis, does a great job of working individually with guys, like after practice, before practice, shooting sessions with different guys, you know, because you can't get all the work that you want to get in done in a practice because you have to go through plays, learn the defense, learn the offense. So I think the individual sessions with our offensive coach really helped our team and our guys.
So, you know, what is going to be, this is my last question here, what's going to be the biggest contributing factor for you guys to ultimately win the championship this year?
Honestly, I think it comes down to focus and playing a full game. You know, that's something that we've gotten better and better at over this year. You know, we started out this year maybe only playing two quarters or playing a half, and it was tough to win games when you only play your best for two quarters or 30 minutes. So, and we've been able to put it together more and more since then. You know, we started playing three quarters and then three and a half quarters, yeah. And then these last couple games we've been playing a full game, and it's been really fun.
Well, I hope you guys can put together that full game, and we wish you guys the best of luck. Thanks, Drew. Back to you guys at the studio.
First prospect in the NFL draft now that we're going to look at tonight. Grandmother is too ill to travel. She has type 2 diabetes, so he will have a draft party in Alabama. So you like to see that out of Winston staying behind because of his grandmother. But I know there's another quarterback that you like to talk about.
Another quarterback is Marcus Mariota. He's a great kid who, with a tremendous work ethic, and can definitely be molded into a starting NFL quarterback. His pro day was a big success. One NFL GM said his accuracy while dropping back from center was better than advertised and crucial for a pro-style offense.
Well, that's about all the time we have today. Will you be tuning into the draft tonight?
Yes, we will.
It will definitely be interesting to see when Winston and Mariota are both not there. There hasn't been that with the two picks not there since 1992.
That's true.
But that's definitely all the time we have for today. So, alongside Natalie Gomez, I'm Dan Girolamo. Thank you for watching.